The number one question that popped up, and it's super basic, but because it's the number one question, we got to ask it. How can I get started investing with little money? I had that question just getting started. So I empathize with the question, but the one thing that's you really got to cautious is if you really, really have no money, like there may be other things you should be doing first. Not that you can't learn about investing, but let's go ahead and take the question head on. Does anyone want to?
I like this question because when we say little money, what I would consider to be little money in between $5,000 and $10,000, somewhere between there. If you have less than $5,000, I think it would be very difficult to really kind of get started. And I made the same mistake Brant did as my very first fix and flip. I had right about $7,000, which is what I needed for closing. And I had good credit, right? So notice I was able to actually purchase a full-on rental property for about $7,000. Now this is awesome, but guess where the rehab came from then? My good credit.
Yeah.
My darn credit cards. Yeah. And for the rest of the year, I kept trying to pay off this credit card, and it made it really difficult. However, that deal got me started. And I think a lot of times we focus too much on really, me. The reason I was able to make it happen is I had a good realtor. My realtor was able to introduce me to a good lender. The lender knew I had good credit and not a whole lot of cash in my pocket. So we worked through terms to make sure, all right, hey, look, we'll lend you this amount. We know the property appraised for this. And they worked with me. So really what it comes down to, if you don't have a lot of money, you have to have something else to leverage. For me, it was leveraging my physical credit and leveraging my network. You don't need a lot of money necessarily, but you do need to have some form of leverage.
And I'll ask this, just a follow-up question to that. Did you have a job at the time?
I did.
And so with that job, did you have a decent cushion of disposable income?
Yeah, so that was the thing. That's why I was comfortable putting the rehab on my credit card.
Because if things screwed up, you could at least make the ridiculously high percentage like monthly payments on your credit card. It would have sucked, but you could have done that.
Absolutely. And that was the thing. So sometimes I had actually a close friend of mine recently just quit his job because he's all in. He's going straight into real estate. I'm like, why did you quit your job, bro?
Banks love W-2s.
Oh, man. But I think if you don't have a lot of money, you need to be able to leverage something else. So for like Chris, it could be the contract work. For Mallory, it could be the network, with the being a realtor, right? For Luke, it's the knowledge in the syndication aspect. If you don't have money, you need to be able to leverage something else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Anybody else got any thoughts there?
I copied Brant 100%, man. I know stuff from early on. If you guys have never worked with Brant, you need to.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of my favorite questions, and it's a loaded question. So for some, and it's different for everybody. For some of you listening to this who have no money that want to get started in real estate, maybe you shouldn't, okay? But there's some of you, because I don't know your background, I don't know your commitment level, I don't know a lot about each and every one of you listening to you, but I know that there's a percentage of you watching this that were like me when I got started and I had nothing, right? I had no money. Now, like Derek, I had a job, and I had good credit, and I had a massive amount of commitment and drive and just this burning desire that I was going to figure this out somehow, some way I was going to get it done. So whenever I went through Barnes and Noble's bookstores for my millennials, there used to be like these real brick and mortar bookstores, and you had to like buy a book and read it. And so when I went, I was like searching for something. I tried a little internet business, all this kind of stuff. And when I found the real estate section and I saw, I think the first book I saw was like Ron LeGrand. I'm not Ron LeGrand, but I'm forgetting his name now. Help me out, Chris. No Money Down. Robert Allen. Yeah, Robert Allen. It's like Robert Allen. Yeah. Like No Money Down, How to Buy Real Estate with No Money. I'm like, oh my God, they wrote a book just for me. How awesome is this? And so I love the question about you know, people getting started with no money down. I love, and I especially love it whenever they frame it as like a kind of a mindset, a limiting mindset. Well, I can't get started because I have no money. That's a loaded question that I love. But really, real estate is really, really it is creative. And Derek hit the nail on the head where you have to leverage something. It could be that you're willing to go door knock for 25 hours a week, right? And bring deals to the table, whatever it is. You've got to leverage something. So what I would say is if you're getting started from zero, you can absolutely do it. The question is how. And what you need to do is just start with that commitment and that burning desire that you're going to figure it out. And you're going to back that up with massive amounts of action, talking to people, networking, reading, watching videos, all that kind of stuff, and really building out a game plan. And the last thing I would say with that, that something I didn't know back then, but something I've learned since and I apply into all my business endeavors, is you really, especially, this is critical when you're just getting started with no money, is you have to focus on low risk, high reward deals. Low risk, high reward, right? So where I'm at in my business, that's where I'm at, right? I've done a lot of high risk and, you know, I'm sorry. Yeah. High risk and the rewards not much greater, right? Or low reward. You don't do that deal. So you have to be really, really careful when you're starting out, look for low risk deals with super high reward, right? And know that not every deal is going to go bad, but if you have a good game plan together and you have that mindset, more than not are going to work out, and it's not going to take you very long to get some good traction going, right? So then, and you know, that's how you get your feet wet, but just kind of start with that burning desire and the commitment that you're going to get it done, and then go find a way to get it done the right way, of course, because if you go too soon, you don't want to make that mistake, right? Where you come in too soon, like, you know, Derek's friend who's quitting his job and doing all that kind of stuff. I worked my full-time job for 2.5 years while I did real estate on the side, pretty much full time. And I picked my spots the right way. I've had friends, I've had students, associates who quit their job too soon or who did a bad deal right out of the gate, and it knocked them out financially and mentally. And so even so much, you know, this topic, when, you know, I was doing a lot of coaching and still do a little bit of coaching to this day, when I, you know, working with somebody new and the question comes up very soon in the process, how much money do you have to invest in real estate? I don't care if they have, you know, $100 or $1 million, it doesn't matter. My response to them is the same. And I say, what I want you to do is I want you to pretend like you're dead broke, like you have no money. How can we get this done? And actually having no money, me having no money in the beginning, was actually one of the biggest blessings ever, because it forced me to find better deals. It forced me to negotiate better deals, not only with sellers, but with contractors, with wholesalers, with lenders, all that kind of stuff. It just forced me to be a better entrepreneur because I didn't have a bunch of money in the bank.
Love it. Luke, do you have any thoughts there?
Yeah, no, I totally agree with both everybody, what everybody else said, but also, you know, I think not even having enough money to start, but as long as you bring the value or the work, and it could be just a small win, just to get you over that first hump, and that will give you a lot more confidence on producing or scouting out more deals, whether again you're doing it on yourself or you're partnering. Again, I think, you know, I don't think it takes absolutely no money to get into this, because you still need marketing money or driving money. I mean, it takes at least a little bit of money, but for the big money, if there's a deal, you usually can find somebody to work with. But another obstacle is just getting that first one under your belt. I mean, because everybody remembers that first flip, and it's like, wow, okay. And then it's got easier and easier. Then you're like, well, let me go bigger and bigger. I mean, from the last deal I did, I didn't think that was going to come that soon and that big, but you know, with the right people in the right places and you know, some persistence and just keep plugging forward, you know, things happen.
Love it. Any thoughts, Mallory?
Yeah, I was thinking on this too. One thing that's, you do have to kind of get that first deal. I think you got to kind of build some clout and show that you're actually capable and able. But private money is something that goes a long way. So even if you don't have the ways to get all the financing and the traditional route, don't be a secret investor, because we have realized that there's so many people in our little network or family or friends that want to invest, and they have money that they want to throw at deals. So, you know, something Daniel really realized is you feel like you're kind of initially like asking for money, like, oh, we need money. We're going to buy this $300,000 house and flip it. Well, no, like these folks are benefiting. They're actually getting paid interest by us. Mm. We're helping them.
You're giving them an money. Opportunity.
Right. We're providing an opportunity. So go into it with that understanding that, you know, you're not a beggar on the street here. You're actually providing content to them. Sorry, my dishwasher, that they can benefit from. And then there's a lot of people with money ready to go for it. So could you even hear me? Sorry.
I think we have the same dishwasher.
Yeah, it's very vocal. Anyway, Daniel tried. But yeah, try private money. Just don't be a secret agent. Don't be a secret investor. Let people know what you're doing. And, you know, there's plenty of opportunity with other people that have the funds to fund the deal for you.